Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Seiji Ogo from Kyushu University, I²CNER. Today, we are very happy to have the I²CNER seminar series with Professor Domen. Before his talk, I'd like to introduce him quickly. Professor Domen is a professor of Department of Chemical System Engineering, School of Engineering, the University of Tokyo. Professor Domen received his Bachelor of Science in 1976 and Master of Science in 1979 and his PhD in 1982 in chemistry field from the University of Tokyo. In 1982, he joined Chemical Research Resources Laboratory, Tokyo Institute of Technology as assistant professor and was subsequently promoted to associate professor in 1990 and full professor in 1996 at the same institute. And in 2004, he moved to the University of Tokyo as full professor. Professor Domen has been worked on overall water splitting reaction on heterogeneous photocatalysts to generate clean and recyclable hydrogen. His research interests now include heterogeneous catalysis and materials chemistry, with particular focus on surface chemical reaction dynamics, photocatalysis and solid acid catalysis and mesoporous materials. Today, he is going to give us a lecture of hydrogen production from water on heterogeneous photocatalysis. Okay, Professor Domen, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Ogo, for your very kind introduction. And actually, I know Professor Ogo for a long period, since he was an undergraduate course student. And it is my great pleasure to have an opportunity to talk about our works here in I²CNER, Kyushu University. And the title of my talk today is Hydrogen Production from Water on Heterogeneous Photocatalysts. And here I show the content of my talk. After a brief introduction about water splitting reaction, I'll briefly introduce a UV light responsive photocatalyst. Then I move to the development of visible light responsive photocatalysts. And this is a main part of my talk, over water splitting under visible light irradiation. This part will be divided into two parts. Then at the end of my talk, I'll just like to introduce our recent attempt of a water splitting panel. Okay, another introduction. Okay, our target reaction is very simple. We want to split pure water into hydrogen and oxygen on heterogeneous photocatalysts. Of course, the motivation of this work is as follows. If hydrogen is produced from pure water and solar energy in a large scale, then hydrogen could be clean and recyclable energy carrier. At first, let me just very briefly introduce the basic principles of over water splitting reaction. Here, I see the proton hydrogen, water oxygen, redox potential versus normal hydrogen electrode. This is the band gap positions of semiconducting type photocatalysts referring to this axis. And under photo irradiation, electrons in the valence band are excited in the conduction band levels. And if the bottom of the conduction band locates more negative than this proton hydrogen redox potential, then these photo-excited electrons are possible to reduce protons into hydrogen molecules. But as I showed here, in most cases, we need to introduce some active site for hydrogen evolution to facilitate this electron transfer to proton and to generate hydrogen molecules. On the other hand, if the top of the valence band locates more positive than this water oxidation redox potential, then these photo-excited holes are possible to oxidize water molecules into O2 molecules. And so far, in most cases, no oxygen evolution co-catalysts have been introduced. But today, I'd like to discuss a little bit about the effect of the co-loading of oxygen evolution co-catalyst with hydrogen evolution co-catalyst. Okay, now the UV light responsible photocatalyst. Actually, we have been working on this type of photocatalyst for more than 30 years. And at present stage, of course, including with other many groups in the world, it is possible to say that under UV light irradiation, many efficient photocatalysts have already been established. And actually, in some cases, the quantum efficiency, not the solar energy conversion efficiency, quantum efficiency can exceed 50%. And here I show the three photocatalysts which have been developed in our group. This is one of the oldest photocatalysts that I have developed when I was a graduate course student in 1980. In this case, we utilize the strontium titanate small powder, which is modified by nickel oxide nickel quartz structure. This is one of the first examples which evolved both hydrogen and oxygen on a particulate photocatalytic systems. But of course, in this case, the quantum efficiency was very low, less than 1%. After that, we have developed this kind of layered type photocatalyst. In these cases, the intercalated water molecules were actually reacted to decompose into hydrogen and oxygen. And the quantum efficiency of these photocatalysts were better than these photocatalysts. Then at the, here, let me just show you one typical experiment using this kind of photocatalyst. This is a collaboration with Professor Sakata of Yamaguchi University. And the photocatalyst is a zinc-topped gallium oxide, which absorbs only UV light, which is modified by low-demand chromium mixed oxide. This is our co-catalyst for hydrogen evolution. And this is a SEM image of this photocatalyst. As you see here, this is a powder material. The particle size is about 1 micrometer with some porous structure. And this powder is now dispersed using this inner irradiation type reaction vessel equipped with high pressure mercury lamp. And in this particular case, the product is now coming out here. Okay. And this is a bubble of hydrogen and oxygen, which is evolving on these small particles under photo irradiation. As you see here, we can get hydrogen and oxygen mixture exactly in 2-to-1 ratio with this kind of rate. Okay, in this particular case, the hydrogen evolution rate was about 30 millimoles per hour with the stoichiometric amount of oxygen evolution. And the quantum efficiency in this particular case is about 70% at 254 nanometers. To my best knowledge, this is a photocatalyst which gives the highest quantum efficiency of water splitting reaction under UV light irradiation. Okay, now let me move to the next part, development of visible light responsive photocatalysts. Of course, to efficiently utilize solar energy, we need to develop the photocatalysts which work under visible light irradiation. In that case, we have to develop the photocatalytic new photocatalytic materials with these three conditions. They have to absorb visible light, of course. Then the band gap position has to be suitable for water splitting reaction. And the third condition is that we have to develop a stable materials even during water oxidation or reduction reaction. Actually, it is very difficult to find that such materials that meet these three conditions simultaneously. So our strategy to tackle with this problem is as follows. Actually, we have been working on the oxide-type photocatalyst for a long period. And from our experience, it is very difficult to find efficient oxide materials to work under visible light irradiation because the band gaps, in most cases, becomes too wide to utilize visible light. But I should say that some researchers are actually working on oxide materials, and they are developing very nice photocatalysts. For example, Professor Kudo of Tokyo University of Science is developing some oxide photocatalysts by doping of some metallic or typical element doping method. But it took a little bit different strategy. If we look at some non-oxide type materials such as CDS, CDSE, okay, as you know well, that these materials have good absorption in visible light region, and the band gap positions are actually suitable for water splitting reaction. Only the problem is the stability, that if we try to, for example, CDS to utilize for water oxidation reaction to generate oxygen, instead of this reaction, the photo-excited holes actually directly attacks the CDS itself, and S2 minus anions are oxidized into S0. Then CD2 plus cations are diluted. That means the decomposition of photocatalyst itself. So our question here is as follows. Are there any stable non-oxide type materials? So we have carried out rather extensive survey of such materials, and we have found that some oxy nitride and nitride materials, or some oxy sulfide materials are essentially, unfortunately not perfectly, but essentially stable during water oxidation or reduction reaction. So today I will focus our attention on the oxy nitride type materials. Okay, here I schematically show that what we want to do. Okay, this is a schematic structure of sodium tantalate. This is a material which is well known that which works as a photocatalyst for water splitting reaction and UV light irradiation. The crystal structure of this material is shown here. This is a perovskite type material. And in this case, the band gap structure is like this one. Okay, conduction band is mainly consists of empty tantalum 5D orbitals. On the other hand, the top of the valence band mainly consists of oxygen 2p orbitals. So this material absorbs only UV light. Then what we want to do here is this one. We want to replace this oxygen 2 minus 1 ions by nitrogen 3 minus 1 ions. To keep the charge balance of these materials, we need to increase the cation valency. In this particular case, we replace this sodium 1 plus cation by barium 2 plus cation. Then we will get this barium tantalum oxygen nitride materials. Then, in this case, that the band gap structure would be expected like this one. Actually, nitrogen 2p orbitals potential energy locates higher than oxygen 2p orbitals. So we expect that this kind of band structure. So if we are lucky, if we can reduce this amount of band gap energy, then we will have absorption in visible light region. Okay. Then we actually synthesize such materials like this one. These are the UVB spectra of alkaline earth metal containing tantalum oxygen nitride. As you see here, this is one of the precursor oxide materials. There is no absorption in visible light region. But once we introduce nitrogen in the coordination sphere of tantalum, as you see here, we can get a good absorption in visible light region. Especially in the case of barium tantalum oxygen nitride, the absorption edge is longer than 600 nanometers. These are the photographs of such materials. This is one of the precursor oxide materials before the introduction of nitrogen by ammonia treatment. And after the introduction of nitrogen, as you see here, all of these materials are colored. That means that these materials absorb visible light region photons. Okay, now let me move to the next part. Overall water splitting reaction under visible light irradiation. At first, gallium nitride zinc oxide, solid solution materials. Okay. Gallium nitride is a very well-known semiconducting material as a blue light emitter. The crystal structure of this material is a so-called ulcite type structure. And interestingly, the lattice constant between gallium nitride and zinc oxide also has this ulcite type structure, and the lattice constant of these two materials are very close to each other. The lattice mismatch is only about 0.8%. However, from the viewpoint of a photocatalytic reaction, unfortunately, both of these materials have the band gaps in UV light region. However, if we mix these two materials, we can get some different absorption. Okay, to mix these materials, we carry out this kind of nitridation procedure. At first, we mix zinc oxide powder and gallium oxide powder with the excess amount of zinc oxide, like this one. Then we nitride under atmospheric pressure ammonia flow like this one and at these high temperatures. Okay, then we obtain this gallium nitride, zinc oxide, not zinc nitride. Gallium nitride and zinc oxide mixture. And this is the X-ray pattern of these samples. Okay, the top panel shows that pure zinc oxide. The bottom one shows the gallium nitride, which is prepared by our method from gallium oxide. Okay, these three are the X-ray patterns of our samples. Okay, as you see here, in all cases, we observed only the single phase of ulcite type materials. And with the increase of the zinc oxide content in this material, now here I expanded this peak here. Okay, with the increase of the zinc oxide content, this peak shifts from gallium nitride side to zinc oxide side. This kind of behavior is indicative of the formation of a solid solution between gallium nitride and zinc oxide. And the interesting point of this solid solution is shown here. Okay, with the increase of the zinc oxide content, this X indicates the content of zinc oxide. And with the increase of the zinc oxide content, as you see here, the absorption edge is shifted into the visible light region. And then that recently, we know that if we increase this X to about 0.7 point, then that absorption edge can shift to about 600 nanometers. But anyway, the increase of the zinc oxide content, we have absorption in the visible light region. This is absorption that we want to utilize for water splitting reaction. Okay, this is a photograph of this material. Okay, this is a gallium nitride powder. Gallium nitride powder should have a white colored powder. But in this case, we purchased this one from Mitsubishi Chemicals. And in this particular case, there remains a small amount of gallium metal. That's why that it is colored gray. On the other hand, the zinc oxide is a white colored powder. However, if we make a solid solution between these two materials, we obtain this kind of yellow colored powder. And this is a SEM image of this powder. As you see here, this powder consists of particles. This is 1 micrometer scale. So that this powder consists of a particle size of about a few hundred nanometers. Okay, in this particular case, we have already loaded the 3.58% ruthenium dioxide as core catalyst. I hope that you can see some small particles are dispersed on this gallium nitride zinc oxide solid solution particles, like this one. Okay, this is a typical feature of our material to use for water splitting reaction. Then we try to apply these materials as photocatalysts for water splitting reaction. I'm sorry, this is a little bit busy table, but here I show that our attempt to develop the photocatalyst for water splitting reaction. At first, we utilize this yellow powder itself without any modification, and under photo irradiation, we didn't see any activity. Then we modified that yellow powder by various kind of transition metal oxide, not the transition metal itself, transition metal oxide. Okay, as you see here, when we modify by nickel oxide or ruthenium dioxide, we observed some activity of hydrogen and oxygen inversion. Actually, these two materials, nickel oxide and ruthenium dioxide, have been known for a long period as effective core catalysts for water splitting reaction. However, interesting point in this table is this one. When we loaded chromium oxide, okay, no activity. That means that the chromium oxide itself does not work as core catalyst for water splitting reaction. However, when we co-loaded this chromium oxide with some with these other transition metal oxide, we observed a significant enhancement effect, as shown here. Okay, now compare these two numbers. Okay, these are the photocatalytic activity of the photocatalyst co-loaded with this chromium oxide and other transition metal oxide. As you see here, in all cases, the overall water splitting activity was enhanced very much. For example, in the case of copper oxide and chromium oxide co-loaded system, as you see here, when we loaded on the copper oxide, activity was negligible. However, this chromium oxide and copper oxide co-loaded system shows a very good activity for overall water splitting reaction. And among all of these combinations, the rhodium and the chromium mixed oxide loaded system shows highest activity. So now let me focus our attention on this combination. Okay, this is a typical time course of overall water splitting reaction under visible light irradiation on gallium nitride zinc oxide modified by rhodium and chromium mixed oxide. Okay, as you see here, more than 30 hours, we can get both hydrogen and oxygen evolution steadily in stoichiometric ratio. And in this particular case, the quantum efficiency was about 5.2% at 410 nanometers. As I said, that under UV light irradiation, now the quantum efficiency can reach to 70%. So comparing to that number, this number is still not satisfactory. So we are struggling to improve this quantum efficiency every day. But today, let me anyway explain that this photocatalyst. Okay, this is a little bit different experiment using this photocatalyst. This is a long-term water splitting reaction. Here I plot under the intensity similar to sunlight. In this case, I just plotted the accumulated amount of evolved hydrogen as a function of reaction time per day. I see here, after about 90 days, this photocatalyst evolves steadily the hydrogen. That means that the water splitting reaction. And after that, that activity started to degrade gradually. We know that this is due to the, not really due to the degradation of the material itself, but the contact between the hydrogen evolution catalyst and the semiconducting photocatalyst itself became worse. So we are now trying to improve this durability of this photocatalyst. Okay, the question here is that, actually, what is the role of these core catalysts? So to examine that part, we utilize so-called sacrificial reagent or so-called reducing or oxidizing reagent. At first, we utilize methanol as reducing reagent. Okay. In this case, when we utilize a gallium nitride zinc oxide itself without any modification, even in methanol aqueous solution, we didn't see any activity of hydrogen evolution. On the other hand, when we utilize a rhodium chromium mixed oxide loaded system, of course, in this case, we observe good activity of hydrogen evolution. But in this case, we didn't see any activity of oxygen evolution. Instead, instead of the water oxidation reaction, this methanol oxides into carbon dioxide. We also examined the ruthenium dioxide modified system. Of course, in this case, we observed the hydrogen evolution activity. However, the activity was about an order of magnitude lower than that modified by rhodium chromium mixed oxide. And maybe some of you know better that metallic rhodium should be a good co-catalyst for hydrogen evolution. Of course, in this case, it gives a good activity for hydrogen evolution like this one. But comparing to this one, it is somewhat lower than the rhodium and chromium mixed oxide system. Then we switched the sacrificial reagent from methanol to silver cations. This is a good oxidizing reagent to evolve oxygen. In this case, without any modification, we observed good activity of O2 evolution. Then we modified by rhodium and chromium mixed oxide. In this case, we of course observed the O2 evolution activity. However, as you see here, the O2 evolution rate decreased by this modification. We also examined the ruthenium dioxide modified system. In this case, we observed a very good activity of O2 evolution, even higher activity than that without any modification. So from this experiment, probably we can conclude that this ruthenium dioxide co-catalyst seems to be working for both hydrogen and oxygen evolution co-catalyst. However, this rhodium and chromium mixed oxide co-catalyst, this co-catalyst dominantly works as a very efficient hydrogen evolution co-catalyst and not for O2 evolution co-catalyst. So from this kind of observation, we can now elucidate the reaction mechanism on this photocatalyst. This is the SEM image of this photocatalyst. Again, that about 20 to 30 nanometers small particles are dispersed on this photocatalyst. This is a more magnified TEM image. This part is gallium nitride zinc oxide. This part is loaded rhodium and chromium mixed oxide, which is confirmed by TEM analysis. Then under photo irradiation, electrons and holes are excited within this gallium nitride zinc oxide solid solution. And then some part of photo excited electrons migrate through this boundary to the surface of rhodium and chromium mixed oxide, where protons are reduced into hydrogen molecules. On the other hand, photo excited holes are migrated to the surface of the gallium nitride zinc oxide, where water molecules are oxidized into O2 molecules, like this one. And we believe that this is a reaction mechanism of water splitting reaction on this photocatalyst. Now let me show you a typical experiment using this photocatalyst. Again, that okay. This is And this is the bubbles of hydrogen and oxygen, which is evolving on that yellow powder. In this particular case, the quantum efficiency at 420 nanometer was about 3%. Okay, then the question is still remains that what is actually the role of the chromium oxide corroding? So we have not yet fully understood the role of the chromium oxide. But let me give you one of the possible explanations of the role of chromium oxide here. Okay, in this case, at first, we consider that metallic rhodium loaded gallium nitride zinc oxide here. Okay? Then in this case, what we expect is that on the metallic rhodium surface, the proton is possible to be reduced to dihydrogen molecules. On the other hand, water molecules are possible to oxidize into O2 molecules on gallium nitride zinc oxide. However, in this particular case, we also consider that reverse reaction from hydrogen and oxygen to water molecules would proceed on this metallic rhodium. So we don't expect so high activity for this catalytic system. But if we can modify the surface of this metallic rhodium by some inert materials, of course, in this particular case, we suppose that the chromium oxide, like this one, then that this kind of reverse reaction could be prevented. then it is still possible to transfer this electron to this proton into hydrogen. We could get some stable activity for water splitting reaction. And to form this kind of structure, we utilize some chromium 6 plus photoreduction reaction to form chromium 3 plus oxide material. It was reported in this review article. OK, now let me show you our experimental result. OK, at first, we deposited metallic rhodium by photodeposition method from rhodium 3 plus cations, like this one. OK, this part is gallium nitride zinc oxide. These are the metallic rhodiums. The particle size is about 2 to 3 nanometers. Then we introduce a chromium oxide layer by chromium 6 plus cations reduction, photoreduction reaction. Okay, this part is metallic rhodium, like this one. And this part is chromium oxide shell. Okay, so this is more schematic structure. So now we prepare this kind of structure. We have gallium nitride zinc oxide, which has a metallic rhodium core and chromium shell. The thickness was about 2 nanometers. Now the question is, that does this structure work for water splitting reaction or not? Then we carried out our experiment. Okay, at first, we utilized a metallic rhodium loaded one without any chromium shell. In this case, under photo irradiation, we didn't see any appreciable activity of water splitting reaction. Then we utilized this core shell structure, like this one. Okay, in this case, we clearly observed both hydrogen and oxygen evolution takes place steadily. Then we mix these two materials, 1-to-1 ratio, in the same aqueous solution. Then, as you see here, the overall water splitting activity has almost disappeared. In this case, we believe that although overall water splitting reaction proceeds on this quasi-shell structure, however, the reverse reaction from the evolved hydrogen and oxygen on this metallic rhodium proceeds faster. That's why we are not able to accumulate enough amount of hydrogen and oxygen in our system. That means that the property of the hydrogen evolution site is essential to get a good activity for overall water splitting reaction. And actually, we prepare this quasi-shell structure carefully, then activity of this quasi-shell structure can exceed the activity of the chromium and the rhodium mixed oxide loaded system. But still, there remains how this quasi-shell structure works for hydrogen evolution site and how to prevent the reverse reaction. Okay, that this electron is transferred by some kind of tunneling to the surface, to this one, and to reduce the proton into hydrogen. To examine this part, we carried out a model electrode experiment. In this case, we utilized a macroscopic metallic rhodium electrode, and the surface was modified by chromium layer, by electrophoretic electrode deposition method. The thickness was controlled to about 2-3 nanometers. Okay. Then these are the results of the cyclic bottomogram of such electrodes. For the reference, we also used metallic rhodium. And at first, we carried out the experiment in argon atmosphere. Okay. In the case of metallic electrode, it is well known that here we have a proton reduction and adsorption, hydrogen atom adsorption shoulder. This is a hydrogen evolution current. Cathodic current. When we utilize chromium oxide, modified metallic rhodium electrode, we are not able to scan to this side because of the dissolution of chromium oxide. However, as you see here, we clearly observe that the same shoulder here, that this is a proton reduction adsorption, and this is a hydrogen evolution current. That means that proton can penetrate this chromium oxide layer. Then we switched the gas phase from argon to oxygen. Of course, in the case of metallic rhodium surface, this under oxygen atmosphere, we observed oxygen reduction reaction current to form water molecules from these O2 molecules here. However, when we coated this metallic rhodium surface by chromium, then that you see no oxygen reduction reaction current was observed. Almost the same curve with argon atmosphere. That means that this O2 molecules cannot penetrate this chromium oxide layer. And the last question is hydrogen molecules. So we switch the gas phase from oxygen to hydrogen, like this one. And this is a result of a chromium covered rhodium electrode. As you see here, Under hydrogen atmosphere, we observed this amount of anodic current. This current should be attributed to hydrogen oxidation reaction current. That means that actually hydrogen molecules can penetrate this chromium layer. Okay. From all of these experimental results, now we can elucidate the detailed reaction mechanism of water splitting reaction on this photocatalyst. Still, we don't know the detailed mechanism of water oxidation into O2 molecules on gallium zinc oxide. On the other hand, photo-excited electrons migrate to this metallic nanoparticles, in this particular case, metallic rhodium. And then proton can penetrate this layer, chromium oxide layer. Then it is reduced into hydrogen atoms, then hydrogen molecules. As I showed, the hydrogen molecules can penetrate this layer into aqueous solution and eventually into gas phase. On the other hand, O2 molecules cannot penetrate this layer, so we can very effectively prevent a reverse reaction from the product of hydrogen and oxygen to form water molecules. Okay, this is a reaction mechanism that we believe that proceeding on this co-shell structure photocatalyst. Okay, so far I just discussed on the co-catalyst of hydrogen evolution. Now here, let me discuss about a little bit about the co-loading of O2 evolution co-catalyst. On this one, will it be effective or not? Okay, to examine that part, at first we chose the manganese oxide nanoparticles. Okay, this manganese oxide nanoparticles was actually prepared by Professor Teranishi's group of Kyoto University. The particle size is about 9 nanometers, like this one. Then we loaded this manganese oxide nanoparticle on gallium nitride zinc oxide. Then we calcined in air at 673 Kelvin. By this treatment, these MnO nanoparticles were transformed to Mn3O4 nanoparticles, like this one. But at this stage, there was no activity for water splitting reaction. That means that this Mn3O4 did not work as hydrogen evolution co-catalyst. So we introduced a hydrogen evolution co-catalyst, that is a rhodium and chromium co-shell structure, like this one. Okay. These are the, this is a TM image of such photocatalyst. Okay. Here we have a Mn3O4. This part is rhodium and chromium co-shell structure. Okay, this is a more magnified TM image. Here we have a rhodium and chromium co-shell structure. This is a Mn3O4. And this is a 5 nanometer bar, so the particle size is almost 10 nanometers. That is the same size with the original MnO nanoparticles. Okay, then we use these materials as photocatalysts. Here I show the, our experimental result. This blue curve is the result of the only hydrogen evolution, rhodium chromium co-shell structure was attached. Then this red curve is a co-loading of Mn3O4 and rhodium chromium co-shell structure. As you see here, we observe that this amount of enhancement effect of water splitting reaction. Maybe you consider that this kind of small enhancement effect is a kind of experimental errors. But my student, Mr. Shun, is a very careful student, and actually this difference is reproducible. Then he examined, instead of Mn3O4, iridium dioxide. This is also known as a good co-catalyst for O2 evolution. Again, you see, we observed this amount of enhancement effect. Then we switch to the ruthenium dioxide. As I showed previously, that ruthenium dioxide seems to be working both for hydrogen evolution and oxygen evolution. And again, the co-loading of ruthenium dioxide shows that this amount of enhancement effect. Here, I summarize all of these three O2 evolution co-catalyst result, co-loading result. You see, this is the level of hydrogen evolution of water splitting without any O2 evolution co-catalyst. Then, with the increase of this co-loading of this O2 evolution co-catalyst, we observe some enhancement effect of the activity. However, if we loaded more amount of these oxygen evolution co-catalyst, the activity was decreased. And if we increase much more, then the activity decreased, actually. On the other hand, you see that optimum amount of oxygen evolution co-catalyst was about 0.01 to 0.03 weight percent. On the other hand, the optimum amount of hydrogen evolution co-catalyst is, for example, for rhodium, is about 1 weight percent. So the optimum amount of hydrogen evolution and the oxygen evolution co-catalyst are about, by about two orders of magnitude different. So we don't know at present state that why that this OC evolution co-catalyst gives us such a optimum activity with such a small amount of loading, and the enhancement effect is not really so high. But at present, what we are considering for our system is like this one. Actually, the co-loading of this kind of O3 evolution co-catalyst is effective. However, to some extent, only about 30% enhancement effect. So we believe that to obtain the much higher activity, we should have at first improved the our gallium-nitride zinc oxide semiconducting material itself's property. I mean that we should decrease the defect in this material in the bulk as well as on the surface. So we're now trying to improve this kind of semiconducting properties. Okay, now let me move to the next part, two-step overall water splitting reaction. Okay, so far I just talked about the gallium-nitride zinc oxide materials, but as I showed that these materials have some absorption in this visible region, but the absorption edge is in this, this particular case about 500 nanometers. Of course, we want to utilize a wider range of visible region. So in that case, as you see here, these materials seems to be more suitable, right? Actually, these materials has a transition metal containing oxygen nitride and nitride materials. Then, actually, we have been working on this kind of transition metal containing oxygen nitride or nitride materials for about 10 years. But, however, so far, we have never succeeded in overall water splitting reaction based on this kind of transition metal element containing photocatalysts. Here, I show the typical result of our attempts. As you see here, we could observe some hydrogen evolution activity, however, we didn't observe a stoichiometric amount of O2 evolution. Okay, this is a typical time course of unsuccessful overall water splitting reaction. And we, at least, I still believe that it should be possible to split water on this type of materials, but we consider that our materials in these materials contains much larger amount of defects. That's why we are not able to achieve the overall water splitting reaction. However, here let me introduce a little bit different approaches for water splitting reaction. So far, I just explained that this kind of water splitting reactions, I mean that both hydrogen evolution and oxygen evolution takes place on the same type of photocatalyst. We call this type of water splitting reaction as a one-step excitation system. However, that it has been known for a long period, there are a little different types of approaches. That is a two-step excitation or so-called Z-scheme type approaches. Of course, it is named after natural photosynthetic reaction. In this case, two different types of photocatalysts are actually introduced in the same aqueous solution. And on the one type of photocatalyst, only O2 evolution takes place. On the other hand, on the another type of photocatalyst, only hydrogen evolution takes place. And these two photocatalysts are actually combined by so-called redox shuttle to combine this photo-excited electron holes. Then we decided to apply this type of approaches for our transition metal element containing photocatalytic system. And in this particular case, we utilize tantalum oxide nitride only for hydrogen evolution co-catalyst. And for O2 evolution photocatalyst, we utilize tungsten trioxide, like this one. Okay. And these two photocatalysts are connected by I- IO3- redox shuttle. This I- IO3- redox shuttle was devised by Professor Abe. He is now moved from Hokkaido University to Kyoto University. So this is a collaboration with Professor Abe's group. And here I show that we used some precious metals, platinum itself. And maybe you might afraid that this co-catalyst works as a reverse reaction co-catalyst. But in this case, when we introduce I- minus or IO3- anions, these anions cover this surface of these precious metals particles. So it suppresses the reverse reaction. Then the result is shown here. Oh, sorry, this is for Abe. Okay, this is
time course of hydrogen and oxygen evolution. As you see here, even using this tantalum oxygen nitride, we can get both hydrogen and oxygen evolution takes place steadily. But in this particular case, the quantum efficiency at 420 nanometer was about 0.5%. This is about 5 years ago data. Then we tried to improve this quantum efficiency by modifying this tantalum oxygen nitride. So to modify this tantalum oxygen nitride, we modify the surface by zirconia. Zirconia is a very stable 4+ cations containing oxide materials. And by modifying this zirconia, you see the baseline of these materials is lowered. That means that we are reducing the surface defect by modifying zirconia. And actually, the color of these materials changes from a dark yellow of tantalum oxygen nitride to bright yellow to the zirconia-modified tantalum oxygen nitride. Then we utilize this zirconia-modified tantalum oxygen nitride for water splitting reaction. And then in this case, again, that we can achieve over water splitting reaction. And the quantum efficiency is about 6.3% at 420 nanometers. And to my best knowledge, this is the highest quantum efficiency of water splitting reaction which has been achieved so far. Then we like to extend available wavelengths to longer one in visible light region. So we switch, so far we utilize only tungsten trioxide for oxygen evolution. So here we utilize that for both hydrogen and oxygen evolution photocatalysts, the tantalum oxygen nitride was used for both one. And again that you see, both hydrogen and oxygen evolution takes place. That means that if we apply the two-step excitation system, these tantalum oxygen nitrides can split water into hydrogen and oxygen. Then we like to extend available wavelengths to longer one. So we switch tantalum oxygen nitride to barium tantalum oxygen nitride. Then in this case, again, it is possible to evolve both hydrogen and oxygen in stoichiometric ratio. Then we like to extend the available wavelengths for O2 evolution photocatalyst. So we switch to tantalum 3N5, which is modified by cobalt and iridium. And in this particular case, we utilize the rhodium doped strontium titanate modified by ruthenium. Actually, this is the photocatalyst which was developed by Professor Kudo's group of Tokyo University of Science. This is a very interesting photocatalyst which shows a P-type semiconducting property. And in this case, this photocatalyst can combine with various kind of other N-type photocatalysts without any redox shadow. Just physical contact is enough to transfer this electron to this hole. As you see here, both hydrogen and oxygen evolution takes place steadily, like this one. So far, we have been carried out various experiments using various combinations. And at present stage, the longest wavelength available for O2 evolution is this one, tantalum 3N5. And this red colored powder, the absorption edge is around 600 nanometer. For hydrogen evolution, the longest wavelength is given by this barium tantalum oxygen nitride. This is this kind of brown colored powder. The absorption edge exceeds about 650 nanometers. So at present stage, more than half of the visible light region photons are available for water splitting reaction. Okay, now let me move to the last part of my talk, water splitting panel. Okay, here I showed our image of a future hydrogen production plant and the solar fuels production chemical plant like this one. If we like to make about 500 to 1,000 kiloton per year chemical production plant, this is actually reasonable size of such a chemical plant, we need to develop the photocatalytic or hydrogen production system or solar energy conversion system to about 5 kilometer times 5 kilometer, 25 square kilometers, assuming about 10% energy conversion efficiency. In this case, about 5,000 ton per day water will be necessary, and then about 570 ton per day hydrogen will be produced. Then, in that case, to extend in such a wide area our photocatalytic system, we consider that water splitting panel will be suitable structure. In that case, we have to develop a photocatalyst plate like this one. In this particular case, we just disperse our photocatalyst on glass plate with some amount of silica materials. Then we put this photocatalyst plate on the bottom of our reactor. Then we irradiate from the top of this reactor. Then this is a typical experiment using such a kind of system. Okay, here we have a photocatalyst glass plate here, and we are now irradiating from the top of this reactor by xenon lamp. This is the bubbles of hydrogen and oxygen, exactly in 2-to-1 ratio. And that means that this kind of structure of photocatalyst is still working for water splitting reaction. Of course, in this case, hydrogen and oxygen mixture is coming out. So we have to separate this hydrogen from this mixture. And actually, in our project, we have another group, the expert group of separation using membrane. So they are now developing such a kind of interesting membrane systems to separate hydrogen from this mixture. Okay, now let me summarize my talk. At first, a summary of materials. As I showed that in the case of a typical element containing these kind of solid solution materials, or this zinc germanium system, also possible to split water into hydrogen and oxygen. On the other hand, all of these we call a D0 type photocatalyst. These are transition metal element containing oxygen nitride materials are available for two-step water splitting reaction. But I should emphasize that all of these materials are possible to split water by one-step excitation system. So we are now still struggling to achieve the one-step water splitting reaction based on these materials. And the summary is shown here. And the UV light irradiation, as I showed in the beginning of my talk, the now quantum efficiency can reach about 70%. And visible light irradiation, in the case of one-step excitation system, the quantum efficiency is about 5%. In the two-step excitation system, the quantum efficiency is about 6%. And our tentative goal is shown here. We like to utilize the visible light irradiation photon up to about 600 nanometers, and with the quantum efficiency about 30%. With these numbers, the solar energy conversion efficiency will be about 5%. And from the discussion with some industry people, these numbers will be a good starting point to consider practical application of hydrogen production from water using photocatalysts with solar energy. But see here, there still remain some gaps. So we are still struggling to overcome these gaps in the near future. To do that, what we have to do is here. So far, that the best activity was achieved by these materials. These materials' absorption edge is around 500 nanometers. So we need to move from this kind of materials to these materials. The absorption edge is around 600 nanometers. To do that, we have to decrease the defects in these materials, and we need to develop a more effective co-catalyst system. So we are now developing a new preparation method and a new modification method. Okay, now the acknowledgement. Here I should our collaborators, Professor Teranishi, Professor Sakata, Professor Abe, and Professor Kudos. And these are the co-workers in my group. And especially Professor Maeda, Dr. Maeda is developed gallium nitride zinc oxide. And Dr. Higashi, he's now moved to Kyoto University with Professor Abe. He developed a two-step excitation system. And Dr. Shun, he carried out the co-loading experiments. And this is the financial support for the last 5 years. Okay, thank you very much for your kind attention.